The Gauteng MEC for Human Settlements, Urban Planning and CoGTA, Lebogang Maile, is expected to make an announcement on the future of former Johannesburg City Council Speaker Vasco Da Gama, as well as the current Tshwane Speaker, Katlego Mathebe. Let's go there now live.
In the province, namely the city of Johannesburg and the city of Tshwane, respectively. Based on sound legal advice solicited on the conduct of former Speaker of Johannesburg, Councillor Vasco Da Gama, and current Speaker of the City of Tshwane, Councillor Katlego Mathebe, a final determination on the unbecoming conduct of both Councillor Da Gama and Councillor Mathebe has now been made. At the end of November 2019, we invited the Speaker of the City of Johannesburg, Councillor Vasco Da Gama, to, within 7 days of receipt of our invite, make written representations to us regarding serious allegations leveled against him and to further give reasons as to why he should not be suspended or removed as a councillor. The set time frame has long lapsed, and only after a reminder did the former speaker respond. However, the response by the former speaker did not deal with factual and substantive issues raised in the letter we sent him. This recalcitrant attitude on his part once again displayed his total disregard for meaningful engagement. It is the same type of conduct that deprived the Municipal Council of the City of Johannesburg of the opportunity to deliberate and decide on whether or not to seek independent legal opinion on the question of what constitutes the majority of votes to elect a new executive mayor for the city. On the other hand, in early December 2019, a request was made to the current speaker of the City of Tshwane to explain herself as to why she failed to fulfill her statutory duties by failing to preside over the council meeting held on 5 December 2019. The speaker responded that she recused herself from the council meeting because it was going to deal with a motion of no confidence against her, and as a result, she felt conflicted. Her response is glaringly silent on what made her to suddenly have these feelings of conflict. We deemed her response as unacceptable because she was well aware, way before the council meeting, of the motion of no confidence against her, and the feelings of conflict should have arisen before and not on the 5th December 2019 in the council meeting. We strongly hold the view that her explanation does not, to say the least, make sense. Not unless it was a deliberate act on her part to vitiate the council proceedings in order to prevent the motion against her being carried. It is our carefully considered view that in doing so, the speaker placed a personal interest, which is to remain the speaker by any means necessary, above the interest of the municipality and by extension, the residents of Tshwane. Had she acted appropriately and genuinely felt conflicted, she would have taken the necessary steps before the council meeting by ensuring that the systems and mechanisms were in place for the proceedings of the council meeting to be conducted without any disturbance. It is worth mentioning that another special council meeting was held on 16 January 2020, where, amongst others, another motion of no confidence against the speaker was supposed to be tabled. Instead, the council proceedings descended into chaos and total collapse of the set scheduled meeting. Accordingly, an official letter was dispatched to the speaker to request a detailed and comprehensive report on the underlying circumstances that led to council proceedings to be marked by chaos and walkouts by other parties represented. Such a report has not been forthcoming from the speaker, despite a reminder. Notwithstanding her failure to respond, another letter was dispatched requesting a meeting with the Speaker to afford her the indulgence and opportunity to provide a detailed oral account of what happened during the proceedings. Unfortunately, such a request was declined with an explanation devoid of substance and total disregard of the decorum of her office. We received a belated response from the Speaker yesterday. However, her response still failed to address the important substantive issues raised in our previous letters. Given the above exposition on the two matters, the MEC responsible for COGTA in any province is enjoined by the Constitution and various legislation to take decisive action against unbecoming behavior by any elected representative within the sphere of local government. The decision should be located and understood within the context of ensuring that public officials are held accountable and face serious consequences for their despicable actions. This is so, especially if such conduct undermines the tenets of cooperative governance as enshrined in the supreme law of the land, the Constitution of the Republic. Section 151, subsection 2 of the Constitution of the Republic of South Africa, Act number 8 of 1996, dictates that the executive and legislative authority of a municipality is vested in its municipal council and not the Speaker. Section 160, subsection 8 of the Constitution further dictates that, and I quote, members of a municipal council are entitled to participate in its proceedings and those of its committees in a manner that allows parties and interests reflected within council to be fairly represented, is consistent with democracy, and may be regulated by national legislation, and I close quote. The former Speaker of the City of Johannesburg conduct on 27 November can therefore be succinctly described without any doubt as a serious contravention of not only item 2 of the Code of Conduct for councillors as embedded in Schedule 1 to the Local Government Municipal Systems Act number 32 of 2000 as amended, but of the constitutional dictates as alluded to above. As such, it would be fair and just to reasonably consider the former Speaker to be a constitutional delinquent. In the circumstances, having followed the letter of the new, informed by the gravity of the breach, we accordingly invoked our powers in terms of item 14, subsection 6, subsection A of the Code of Conduct for Councillors as embedded in Schedule 1 to Local Government Municipal Systems Act number 32 of 2000 as amended, and we have decided to suspend the former Speaker of the Council of the City of Joburg as a councillor for a period of 3 months without pay, effective from today. We have served him with that letter today. The recently inaugurated Speaker of the City has also been informed of this sanction with a directive to implement same without any delay. This sanction has been enforced to send a strong message and set a precedent that no one should ever play partisan politics to the detriment of the electorate or the residents in our province. In relation to the current Speaker of Tshwane, in spite of my counsel prior to the meeting of 16 January 2020 and subsequent invite after the collapse of the council meeting, the Speaker enjoyed with an unbecoming behavior. The majority of councillors requested a special council sitting for 13 January in terms of Section 29, subsection 1 of the Local Government Municipal Structures Act number 117 of 1998 as amended. The purpose of this meeting was to once again move a motion of no confidence against the Speaker and other office bearers as the main agenda items. The proposed agenda by the majority of council members was to start with the motion of no confidence against her. However, at the commencement of the council meeting, a number of points of order and objections were raised by the same majority of council members who called for a special meeting in terms of Section 29, subsection 1 of the Structures Act. The reasons for these objections were as a result of the Speaker's unilateral and arbitrary decision of altering the sequence of the agenda items in question. Notwithstanding the litany of objections from the majority of council members, the Speaker deliberately elected to ignore these legitimate objections. This is in spite of the fact that the councillors pleaded with her to hear them out. The total disregard of the majority of councillors, pleased by the Speaker, in our view, constitutes a gross abuse of power in her part. We are reliably informed that the Speaker's reasoning for the alteration of the sequence of the agenda items is based on Rule 8, subsection 3 of the Rules and Orders of the City of Tshwane. We are fully conversant with this rule and accept that it is the Speaker's prerogative to determine the order of the business at the special council meeting. However, this is not an unbridled prerogative. This is so because any exercise of any statutory power requires the functionary of that power to properly apply his or her mind informed by facts taking a decision. Simply put, such a decision with serious ramifications must pass the rationality test. The said commission or deliberate omission by the Speaker can best be described as irrational, as it cannot be justified and is detached from the facts. Our conclusion, amongst others, is informed by the sequence of events that led to the collapse of the first council meeting and subsequent special council meeting. Clearly, the Speaker's overall conduct was blatantly motivated to collapse the entire council proceedings to safeguard her self-interest at the expense of the interest of the residents of Tshwane. We must put on record that we viewed the collapse of the special council meeting of 16 January 2020 in a very serious light. In this regard, we therefore requested the Speaker in a letter dated 16 January 2020 to provide us with a comprehensive written report on the collapse of the said council meeting. In addition, we also deemed it appropriate to have an audience with her on 20 January 2020, as per our letter dated 17 January 2020. Regrettably, the Speaker declined our invite without any substantive reasons and also failed to furnish us with a comprehensive report as requested. The Speaker's overall conduct in both council meetings and after leaves much to be desired. The vigor with which she behaved to protect her interest to remain the Speaker at all costs, irrespective of the consequences, cannot be tolerated anymore. To allow such insidious conduct without any repercussions will no doubt set an untenable precedent that will permit any office bearer to abuse executive and statutory powers bestowed upon them. The transgressions by the Speaker are by their nature aggravating and warrant her removal from office. Also, the collapse of two council meetings under her watch directly contributed to fruitless and wasteful expenditure, as the convening of council requires resources to be spent, which are quite substantial when looked at from a service delivery perspective. With this in mind, we must act decisively to ensure that it does not become easy and the norm for any councillor to collapse a council meeting without consequences, and as such, we would like to see action being taken against all those responsible by holding them personally liable by recouping the loss or the lost money. This could serve as a deterrent for future contraventions. In the same spirit, we will be meeting with the whips of all parties in Tshwane sometime next week, to be exact on Monday, with the aim of helping them find an amicable manner of engaging in each other so that council can sit, deliberate, and take decisions on critical issues that affect the people of Tshwane. Because the continuous collapse of council has a negative impact on service delivery within the municipality, or any other municipality for that matter, if this is the case. In the circumstances, it is our carefully considered opinion that the Speaker has breached item 2 of the Code of Conduct for councillors. To that end, we invoked the powers vested in us by item 14, subsection 6, subsection A of the Code of Conduct, and have consequently suspended the Speaker as a councillor for a period of 6 months without pay, effective from the date of receipt of this letter, which is today. However, notwithstanding the gravity, we elected to invoke the suspension as a deterrent in line with the spirit of cooperative governance. The acting city manager of the city of Tshwane has been informed of this sanction with a directive to take the necessary steps to implement same without any delay. Our decisions in respect of both councillors are consistent with the law and impartial to avoid any accusation of tilting the balance of forces in council to favor a particular political party. It is imperative to note that these decisions are based on strengthening local government by ensuring those elected into positions of responsibility carry out their work in the best interest of the electorate. The High Court judgment in the case of the unemployed peoples of the Eastern Cape versus Makana Municipality and others has underscored the importance of fulfilling the constitutional obligations of government and at all levels, and consequences of failure by the municipality to deliver basic services to the community. These decisions will be communicated to EXCO for noting. It is important to underscore that these decisions were taken in the best interest of our nascent democracy, and bearing any falsehood being peddled by certain voices that we are abusing our powers for sectarian politics. This is far-fetched and removed from the actual truth, supported or backed by undisputable facts. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Those are the issues.
Thanks, MEC. We can now take questions. You are number one, please introduce yourself. Number two. Number three. Number four.
Names, and the media houses.
Hi, MEC. I'm Christian. I'm Jesse from the old newspaper. MEC, can you just provide some clarity about the speaker in Johannesburg? Because I know the DA is saying that he's still the speaker of council. And you also referred to a meeting on 26 November. Can you just provide some clarity about that, about whether he is still the speaker or not, and what are the reasons for that?
Good morning. I'm Christian Lewis from SABC Television. My question is also linked to that, the former speaker of the city of Johannesburg. When anybody speak about writing to him, asking him about to give representations on serious allegations against him, could we just talk about what those serious allegations are, please? And I think about 2 days ago, there was a Democratic Alliance in Gauteng that had accused you, basically, of targeting the speaker in the city of Tshwane, saying that the ANC believed that she was the only stumbling block to regaining the city of Tshwane. I'd like your comment regarding that, please.
Thank you very much. I'm Belanet Akhavi from Union Africa. Also, just Tshwane. Maybe the legal minds could also assist us in this regard. What does this now mean? Does this mean that the council should go back and perhaps elect a new mayor? I mean, a new speaker? Or does this mean that if there's no speaker, that the council is dissolved? I don't know. I just want a bit of a clarity as far as that is concerned.
Number four.
In terms of your powers, I'm confused as to what powers do you have over the speaker. It's executive authority, that's what I'm aware of. It's executive authority where you have powers against the mayor and his MNCs. But what powers do you have when it comes to the speaker?
Let me see. Thank you very much for the questions, though they are difficult. I thought our message was clear. We are suspending. So I thought you'll just report that we have suspended and not ask questions. The first question about the speaker of Johannesburg, the former speaker of Johannesburg, Mr. Vasco Da Gama. You will remember that there was the first meeting which took place to process a motion of no confidence against the mayor. It was successful by far. But before that meeting, there was a confusion about what constitutes the majority. So that question is linked to what Griselda is raising. I'll come to that issue. There was a confusion about what constitutes the majority. But council voted ultimately and agreed on what constitutes the majority. And in fact, if you look at the law is clear that majority is majority. It has nothing to do with percentages, whether 50% or no, it has nothing to do with that. So after that motion, then there was supposed to be a second meeting to process a motion of no confidence against the Speaker of Johannesburg. The Speaker of Johannesburg and his party, I think, decided to boycott the sitting of council. No, before that, in the same meeting or whatever, I might be mixing up dates, there was a voting subsequently after removing the mayor and installing a new mayor. There was a motion of no confidence against the speaker, and that motion was the session was chaired and conducted by what they call a chair of chairs. The speaker was present in the meeting. And the council at that point successfully passed a motion with a simple majority, I think of 135 or 134, somewhere there, I can't remember. The chair of chairs at the time declared that the speaker has been successfully removed. The speaker was in that meeting. He then went to the chair of chairs and told him, no, that's wrong. You actually must have 50% plus one. And the meeting did not end well at the time. But the speaker was wrong, conveniently, because a few days earlier, he presided the meeting for the mayor. And the council, the majority in council, which was the DA and the ANC at the time, agreed on the interpretation of what is majority. But when it came to him, he wanted to conveniently change that understanding. So it was clear, because that meeting had taken a decision that there is no speaker from that meeting. And the meeting was then postponed. But because there was no speaker, after a successful motion of no confidence, we advised the municipal manager, the city manager, to convene a council meeting. And the speaker and his party once again boycotted that meeting, hoping that the meeting will not succeed. And you will remember that for the council to succeed, it needs 50% plus one of the total number of councillors. That's where the 2A, the two
DA councillors attended to give council that 50% plus one. So the council meeting corrected and it elected the speaker. So I don't understand this obsession of the DA of wanting to cling to power at all cost. Because these are people who are saying they're Democrats. They must be able to respect democratic outcomes. So there is no speaker called Vasco Da Gama in Johannesburg. He's a former speaker, and we raised the issue that, and that's why we addressed him as such. He's Mr. Vasco Da Gama. Unfortunately, he has not been able to acquire any title like advocate, doctor, whatever. So me and him were misters. He's a Mr. Vasco Da Gama. He's not a speaker. So the speaker of Johannesburg is Ms. Mulwele. That is the speaker who's going to enforce the decision that we have taken. So Mr. Da Gama will not be allowed in that council chamber for the next 3 months. So he's not a speaker. So I hope that clarifies that he's a former speaker and there's one speaker. What are the allegations, Griselda? These are some of the allegations. Sabotaging council. Because, you know, a council sitting is such an important gathering, which is legislated by the constitution and other legislative prescripts. So it can be easy to disrupt council meeting. It can't be right that one person will arbitrarily decide that a council meeting must be postponed, especially when council is sitting in session, because the law says council has the highest decision-making power, and that the legislative and executive authority of council rests with that council. So who are you when you are a speaker to just decide that, no, now this meeting, it's not sitting, we are leaving. It must be the councillors. That's why even the issue of the voting, I mean, of determining the majority, the speaker subjected it to council, for council to vote. He couldn't, because he understood very well that he does not have the power to decide that this is the majority. So we think that the speaker, of the former speaker of Johannesburg, was mischievous to pursue narrow political interests. And therefore, we can't allow that, at least in Gauteng, not after the 2019 elections, at least at the time, some of us were not entrusted with this responsibility. We can't have any council meeting being disrupted in Gauteng. We will take firm action. And that's why now we are even saying people must pay. Because when you organize a council meeting, I don't know how many of you have attended those council meetings. And I don't know if you have seen the volumes of papers or rather documents that are presented there. You can imagine how much it costs to print that agenda. And apart from printing that agenda, there's people who are paid, and sometimes must be paid over time because these councillors are many, to deliver to all these councillors. So there's petrol there, there's overtime, and then there's food that is being used, I mean, that is being provided there. So it's money. It can't be taken for granted that people will just come and disrupt council meeting because their political agenda is not seeing the light of day. So if people are going to decide to postpone or rather disrupt council meetings because of politics, we will deal with them decisively and make sure that they pay back this money. And that's why we will be writing to the municipal manager as the accounting officer to ensure that he enforces this. We will also alert the auditor general, because this is potential fruitless and wasteful expenditure. Because the money that was spent to ensure that there is a successful council meeting, it is spent in vain. Mm-hmm. And this does not augur well with us. The DA accuses us the day before yesterday, Griselda, And we responded. And one of the things we were saying was that this is a clear reflection of a last kick of a dying horse. DA is badly bruised. Remember in 2016, when these coalitions were put in place, they were so excited, so happy that they are governing these cities. And the ANC accepted defeat gracefully in all these cities. It accepted defeat. It never wanted to cling to power. It never wanted to come with the dirty tricks to delay the transfer of power. There was a smooth transfer of power. If in a municipality like Tshwane, there's a clear majority of councillors who want a speaker or a mayor to be removed, why do you derail that process? Why do you come with excuses, very lame excuses? There's a motion that was presented, and the same rule says that the motion must be presented in the format to cancel that it has been suggested. But for some reason, the speaker decides to remove item 1 to number 4. That is why we are saying there must be rationality. Because if you are not rational and you want to do things simply because you are the speaker, simply because you can do it, and so what? You can't have that in our democracy. Even the president is subject to scrutiny. This decision we are announcing here, I can tell you, we are not going to rest. The DA is going to take us to court. They are going to challenge it. They are going to insult us. We are not going to insult them. We will differ with them if they are wrong. But we are convinced that we are correct. We are convinced that what we are doing, it is in the best interest of the people of the city. I mean, this is becoming a circus. We can't be discussing Tshwane for every week. Tshwane meeting, not sitting. Hey, they meet from 10 until 11 in the evening. It can't be right. The municipality must meet, take decisions. The majority, the will of the majority must emerge. Those who don't like them, tough. So the DA can accuse me. I don't have a problem because it's their responsibility as the opposition to punch holes in whatever decisions we take. What we must worry about, it's not whether the DA will oppose us or not. What we must worry about, it's whether the decisions we take are rational, whether the decisions we take are in the best interest of the country, whether the decisions we take are consistent with the constitution and the other legal prescripts of our country. Not whether the DA will respond in this manner or that manner. We are not worried about the DA. Otherwise, they will be useless if they don't attack us, if they don't punch holes in our issues. They are the official opposition here in the legislature because they went out telling people who don't like the ANC that they will oppose the ANC. That's what their voters want. If they stop doing it, they will lose those seats. So we encourage them. They must do it. Disagree with us. There's nothing wrong because we are not allergic to criticism. We understand that in a democracy, we'll always have different views. And if you can't be in the kitchen, you must get out. So we are thick-skinned. Don't worry. I know they are even trying to attend to me as a person. They know I have defeated them many times in the legislature, and they know that I don't relent easily. So I'm not worried about the DA because I'm not acting in my interest here. We must make sure that Tshwane gets to normality. Last week we issued directives with time frames. If the Tshwane municipality is not able to meet and reflect on those directives, we are worried they are not going to meet the timelines, and we want them to meet the timelines. And by the way, I know DA is arguing there's other municipalities, they're not doing this, that, and all that. I can assure you now that there is no municipality that's going to survive our wrath, especially if it's not doing its work. Doesn't matter whether it's an ANC-led municipality or not. And in fact, this decision you are taking has got serious ramification and implications for some of my comrades in the ANC. Because if they do the same as these two councillors, we must act consistently in a principled manner and without fear or favor. And in fact, we'll be even more harsh with them because they are in the ANC, they must expect better. So if you have a doubt that we will deal with any body because they are in the ANC, just wait and see. Wait and see. And that's why we're studying in Mfuleni, where we had put them under administration. And that intervention is not bearing fruits because we have not been hard enough. We have been nice, too nice. So we must up the ante now, and we must make sure that we don't play. The people in Fuleni must get services. It's just but one of many that we will be intervening. And that's why from next week we are meeting with mayors on a one-on-one. So that when we strike, it's not because we are petty or because we are what?
Punitive.
We are punitive. But because we want to make sure that even the two councillors, we are not being punitive. We want them to stay at home and reflect so that when they come back as better people. Because otherwise, if we were punitive, we would have expelled them. We don't want to expel public representatives. It shouldn't be easy because these people were voted by councillors, by community. So it shouldn't be easy to expel a councillor. So what does it mean for Tshwane? Does it mean the council is dissolved? No, it's not. It's not dissolved. The process to dissolve a council can't be taken by an MEC. It's a very heavy decision. It can be initiated, though, by the MEC, but it will involve the Minister of CoGTA National. It will involve the National Council of Provinces, the legislature. It will involve the Executive Council here. So we are far from there. That section 139, subsection 1, remember, I kept on saying there's 7 subsections. It has what is called A, and the A is directives where we are. B is the responsibility where we are, like in Mfuleni. C is the dissolution. So we're not there. This is pure misconduct. There's a code of conduct for councillors. The two councillors have breached that code of conduct. So we are tending to them as councillors. Not you're right that somebody is Lizeka. I don't appoint speakers. I don't appoint mayor. So I can't remove a mayor. I can't remove a speaker. But I can suspend or expel a councillor. And remember, for you to be a speaker or a mayor, you must be a councillor. So obviously, your standing as a councillor, your position, will determine whether you continue to be a speaker or not. And that's why the council of Tshwane will have to meet and decide the fate of the speaker. Because remember, she's not suspended as a speaker, she's suspended as a councillor. But automatically, she can't because she's no longer a councillor. So the council can meet and say, we have confidence in our speaker. She's suspended for 6 months. It's fine, we'll have an acting speaker until the councillor comes back. Mm-hmm. Or they can decide that, no, this councillor is out of order, this speaker. In fact, we have more reasons to remove her. So they can decide whichever position they take. And that's why on Monday, we're meeting with the whips of political parties, just to agree with them how to best manage this issue, because there is no speaker. Who's going to convene the council meeting? The in law, there is no vacuum. The city manager or the official designated by the MEC of COGTA. But because we have said then we are consistent, we are not like other people. We don't make pronouncements and change every day. You know those people who change every day. No. We said we don't want to run any municipality. And we mean it. We don't. We've got our own problems. You know that my portfolio includes housing. There's 1.2 million people who want housing in Gauteng. So if I'm going to be running municipalities, when am I going to give people houses? We've got our own problems. The same department I'm running, human settlement, they got a disclaimer. We must sort it out. There's problems. There's corruption there and all sorts of things. Something that we'll talk about at some other point. What is it that we're doing? So we can't be wanting to run municipalities. We won't be able to. So we don't want to run any municipality, and we want to be clear. But we also don't want to be pushed and be forced to end up taking over municipalities like we have done in Mfuleni. So I hope it clarifies the issue about the council remains. The highest decision-making body is the council there. Whether there's a mayor, there's a speaker, they will decide. If they love their speeches, their speaker so much that they want to wait for her to come back from special leave. Maybe we must call it special leave, not suspension. From special leave granted by the MEC. They can wait for her, no problem.
Thanks, MEC. One. Oh, that's the last question. Go ahead.
Thank you. My name is Colvin from ENCA. MEC, is there precedent for saying that the money used to convene the council should be recouped from the people? I mean, is there precedent for the MEC of local government taking this action of suspending? And then to be clear, when you say that they've been suspended for the 7,000 council, you mean the Tshwane speaker has been suspended for moving the item on the agenda from number 1 to number 4, and the Johannesburg speaker has been suspended for refusing to convene the council or for postponing that other session? I just wanted the act of what did they do, which you thought was declared a constitutional inconvenience. And then, lastly, on the political question. Look, I hear what you're saying, you're not doing this as a politician, but you just described the DA as being in panic mode, or the ANC as having accepted defeat graciously. There's little room for you to get away from that perception that you're acting as a DA politician, an ANC politician against the DA in the city of Tshwane. What's your direct response?
Thank you very much. maybe I must start with the last one. I'm an ANC deployee in government, so there's no secret about it. I'm the member of the ANC. And obviously, I will ideally want the ideas of the ANC to emerge. there's no doubt. That's why we are in politics. it's a battle of ideas. But unfortunately for me, there's also law on the other side which requires of me to act in a particular manner and not abuse my office. And fortunately for the public and everybody else, there is that law which will always constrain us and always give us direction. And in this instance, the two speakers have failed to maintain that thin line. So it's a thin line. It's a thin line because we have had, and I've made this point before, allegations of serious corruption in previously owned ANC-run municipalities. It was a big allegation, 2 billion or so, in Ekurhuleni. even worse, there's the mayor is not just the ANC mayor. It's also my friend, personally. We drink together, me and him. Don't ask me what we drink, but we drink together. Drink water together. He's my friend. But people never expected that. They were shocked. If you go to my social media timelines, some of them were saying, you have changed now. Yeah, you have been bought by this, even bringing ANC factional things and all that. There was an issue, VPS. I found that issue on my table when I came in June last year. Is it June or May? There was a determination made by forensic investigation, and the report was not made public. We released that report. There was an issue in Lesedi municipality. These are all ANC-led municipalities in Lesedi. A security tender, 15 million, and I can't remember what. We acted, and what we did, one of the good things I think we have done, and unfortunately, to other people it might appear like populism, but we were clear why we're doing it. Every time we write a letter to a municipality, we issue a press statement. Every time. So all these things I'm talking about, they're in the public domain. That was even long, and you remember even Eben Mashab. People thought, no, we have a problem. We wrote letters. There's one letter, Mashaba was good in responding and just talking things he doesn't know. I think sometimes he just didn't understand where he was. But there's one he could not respond at all. You know, Mashaba has answers, ne? And his answers are just, they start with, I'm fighting with the corruption of the previous administration, everything, which is good, and we supported him. Because those who are corrupt within our ranks, we want them, because they make us lose votes. Remember, we've been declining as the ANC. So we can't celebrate that we're declining. And the reason we're declining, one of them, is that we've got thieves amongst our... So that's why those who are fighting corruption, we want them. But there was one issue I asked Eman Mashaba, 2016. From 2016, he appointed what is called Section 56 managers. And there's a certain process he must follow. And these are senior positions. I wrote him a letter. I'm still waiting for it. And we've been... That letter on the public platform. So I'm saying there is that thin line, and I will never behave as if I don't respect, represent any political interest or ideology. But there's a thin line, it must be respected. There's Lebogang Maile, the ANC activist, and there's Lebogang Maile, MEC for COGTA. And the laws are not written, they don't have eyes. Those laws, they don't have eyes. When they were written, those who wrote it, they never imagined or hoped that Lebogang Maile would be MEC.